Hello, mate.
Good evening, Al, and welcome all to part 8 of My Life, My Music with the Guvnor, Alan Hudson. How's things?
It's different, isn't it?
It's an absolute mad one, but as always, Al, played in beautifully by Barbara Streisand, Memories the Way We Were, which pretty much sums up what the programme is all about. We play 6 tracks and talk about the thought process, the stories behind the tracks that shaped one of British football, no, not one of British football, one of world's football's greatest ever talents, you.
Well, we cover quite a lot, don't we? I think it's a good show. I would like to listen to it myself. I play it back and I'm quite happy with it. I listen to a lot of stuff on TV and a lot of it's irrelevant.
Yeah.
But no, it's very enjoyable, Paul.
And I think what happens these days, you know, the relevance of radio, TV, media is all about the now, the Premier League. And you guys of yesteryear, and I have noticed because of the coronavirus outbreak that everyone's talking about, we're all in lockdown, we can't get out. Sky TV are now showing some of the old games, and on YouTube, the football clubs are showing some of the old games, something that we've been doing for several seasons.
Well, yeah, I mean, they go back there. I mean, we speak about, you and I speak about it a lot, but I mean, why wait until we get this virus before we show the Maradona show the other night, which was something incredible. You know, they showed the Jimmy Greaves one the other day, which wasn't because of the virus, but it'd been far too long. But we forget the greats too easily. And, you know, as I've said in the past in my pieces, you know, we watch Match of the Day, and then I thought, sitting here last Saturday night, I forgot that it was, you know, it was the night when I don't always put it on, but I put Match of the Day on because I've got interest. And I think, well, I'd rather watch this every day of the week than watch Match of the Day.
Yeah,
and listen to the tribe that's spoken on there. It seems that the people on Match of the Day are just there to have an evening on their own and talk about what they want to talk about. And we watched something quite incredible on Saturday night. Possibly the greatest player of all time.
Would you put him up there as the top player? Because, again, for me, Al, I mean, you're slightly older than what I am. I remember watching you as a kid going down to St Andrews, my dad taking me down. And we always used to play, before we went, and I started going down Birmingham at about the age of 7, and he'd go 7, 8, 9, 10 and 11. And I used to have to pick a couple, and he'd pick a couple. So whoever had picked, say, 8 and 10, if the first goal was scored by them players, I mean, I don't know, I'd probably get a bag of Smarties or something. There was no money involved, but there was that little bit of excitement. And my dad always identified players, so I was really aware of you, of Osgood, of Stan Bowles, of Rodney Marsh, of, you know, all of these great players, Tony Curry, you know. And as a kid, I used to go down there and watch them players intensely.
Yeah, well, I sometimes people might think I'm a bit blasé, but I'm certainly not. I'm outstanding, and we have discussions in the pub, and it makes me chuckle when people say, well, he was better than him, and it's a great pub argument, and it, who was best and all that. And I said, look, a couple of my friends, one in particular, he's a boxing nut. He's come from a boxing family, and he says, you know, he talks about who was the best boxer of all time, and there's always an argument there. But and I say, look, Billy, you don't know until you've been in the ring with them, mate. You don't know till you've been on the field with them. You don't know. You're talking about the greatest player of all time. You never know until you're actually facing one-on-one with Johan Cruyff. It's like you could ask a great defender, you know, who was the greatest player he played against, and they would tell you because they have to face him.
Yeah.
You know, it's all right standing on the terraces or sitting in the stands and say, well, he looks good. But when you're 5-10 feet away from them and they do what they do. And that is why I sat there in awe the other night of Maradona. I've always said that, and I stand by it, that Johan Cruyff is the best player I ever played against. But he was, every time I played against him, three or four times, he was just out of this world, and he was a bit scary at times, you know, because he comes somewhere else. And I just can't even, you know, I know some great players. I played with them and been out socialising with Pelle included, George Best included. But I just can't imagine anyone doing what Maradona, what I watched on Saturday night. And it wasn't just the way he played. It wasn't just the football. It was the circumstances. And I've kind of been in that in a lesser way. And under them circumstances, when I went to Stoke and people wanted me to foul, and everybody said, oh, he's washed up, he won't be able to do it, he won't be able to do it. And they paid a record fee for me, the manager. And it was a big, big thing, because that fine line of you doing it and not doing it, they can crucify you. If you don't live up to that record signing, they want to batter you, they want to crucify you. But I weren't going to let that happen, and my manager helped me through it, which is the way he handled things. And when I think what, you know, when you think that Diego Maradona, he must be one of the only failures at Barcelona, according to this. He didn't live up to what he was supposed to be. And then he went to a second-rate team who had never won the championship and pulled it out from nowhere. And then we see the scenes in the streets and how they treat him. It was frightening. And I had someone come onto my thing on Facebook yesterday and said it's a pity the way he was off the field. And now, as I said, you don't understand, mate, what this kind of genius, what he had to go through, what he had to put up with, and then he had the mafia as well, you know. It's like when Sinatra was up there and the greatest singer in the world, and they targeted him, you know, and there's no way out, I'm afraid. You don't say no to them people, and it's I'm glad that I just had the pressure that I had, because under that pressure and to play like he played was just phenomenal.
And I suppose it kind of leads us into our first track, which is Peter Gabriel and Don't Give Up, because it's something that Diego Maradona didn't do. But when we look at players that we would perceive to be the greatest of them all, the greatest of all time, has there been a player that had more on his shoulders than what Diego Maradona had?
I can't think. I read one day a piece about Pelé, but that was when he was a young kid. And I heard it. I read that he had a terrible upbringing and he was raped by his coach. You know, that's how bad the times were. He was raped by his coach, and this is what it was like in that country, them South American countries. And they showed you the how he was brought up, and we get people moaning about their upbringing, and then we see that, and all right, we see him as a kid with a ball, and it's all right. I've seen kids at school, and I've seen they would have more ability than me, and they could keep the ball up 1,000 times, and they could catch it on the back of their neck, and they could do all these tricks. But Diego could not only do that, he'd done that for fun. He just worked so, and his work ethic was unbelievable. His training, and to be, you couldn't live the life he lived and be that fit off. And these people judge people like Maradona, and they call him a cheat and everything else. And he told you why in the story, because of the Falklands and how they were treated and everything else. Well, I think, you know, it's like when we played, when I played against West Germany, and Revy said, remember what they'd done to us in the war. Yeah. I don't agree with that. That was the furthest thing from my mind, and I wouldn't want to go out thinking something like that. But Maradona went out with that in mind against England, and you know, the Thierry Henry, he didn't go through that, but he cheated against Ireland. But that no one ever mentions it, you know. And that was even a bigger injustice, because he stopped them from going to the World Cup.
And one of ours as well, our Paul Scholes, again, one of the great players of modern times. He put the ball in with his hand. The ball's come over a corner, if my memory serves me right, and he's punched in with his hand in a Champions League game against Zenit St. Petersburg. But nobody ever references that, but they do with Maradona, because do you know what? It was against us. If that would have been Gary Lineker that did it for us, you wouldn't have had this.
I agree entirely, and that's what annoys me about these people that these pundits who sit there talking about football, and they're at the match and they're talking about it, and they're so totally blinkered and biased. Are they told by the TV people to support us while they're on air and don't see anything but England? It's just so wrong. And as you say, you know, they went bonkers in it. But the fitting thing was in that match was that he went and justified the whole thing. He put everything into its rightful place when he scored probably the greatest goal ever in a World Cup, when he made it, the England team, who was all chasing him from his own half and game, and then basically going round who he thought he was the best goalkeeper in the world at the time, Peter Shilton. And he just went by him and laid it past him as if he wasn't there. It was just a phenomenal goal, and it really did. And you see the delight on his face and the crowd. And so that was a two sides to Maradona. He didn't have to cheat. He didn't need to cheat. But I suppose he did need to cheat, because he played in a team. He was the only man, really, that ever won the World Cup on his own.
Yeah, pretty much. And also, as well, when Maradona played at Wembley for the first time in 1980, Argentina were then world champions. So I think Diego was about 16, arguably early 17, when the World Cup came out in Argentina, 78. And I think it was a toss-up between him and Mario Kempes, who got the number 10 shirt. But I remember one run that Diego Maradona did, and it was very, very similar to the goal that he scored in Mexico. The only thing is, at Wembley, it just went past the post, and we don't see that replayed as much as what we do see with the goal that he did score against us in Mexico. And again, that's the difference. Sometimes if it goes in the onion bag, we keep having a repeat of it. Sometimes if it doesn't, we don't see it. But equally, both are just as good. One results in a goal and the other one sadly doesn't.
Well, that's right, but it thankfully for him, it was a more important one that went in, and because otherwise, if Argentina would have won on the strength of the handball, it would have really been a sad moment for him. But he kind of set the record straight by, and they couldn't really argue with him after that. And the England players, who no one mentions the diabolical defending of England. Yeah. The pass back, you know, the when he handled the ball, the silly pass back and thing, the reckless defending, it was awful, you know. And I always say, you know, about Peter Shilton, I played with him at Stoke, and he's a big lad, and he was slow coming out. Yeah. He was slow to coming out to the ball, and Maradona's about 5'5", Peter's about 6'1", upright. And he's got long arms, and he outfought him and outwise him, really, and that was still genius. It was okay, it was cheating, but he's not the first man to do so, and so don't judge him. Just don't judge him by that. He wanted to win that badly, and going back to 66, you know, with a Hurst goal. All right, it was said later on that it was a goal, but they didn't know it. Nobody knew at the time. No, they didn't have a clue. And you had Roger Hunt said, I didn't even bother to follow the ball into the net because I knew it was in. Well, he didn't know it was in. It happened too quickly.
Yeah. And again, so, we take that because that's for us.
Yes, absolutely. Again, absolutely. Yeah.
Again, so if it was the other way around, we'd be arguing. It
would never have been the other way around if it was the Germans. You know, would that have been given in Berlin or Munich? I don't think so. You know, and a Russian linesman. He just had to make his mind up quickly who he liked out best. Did he prefer the English to the Germans, or am I going to get out of the country alive? Probably, you know, if I don't give it.
Peter Gabriel, Don't Give Up, which is your first pick of this podcast. What's the story behind the track there? Were you a big Peter Gabriel fan? Did you like Genesis? Or is it just the song that evokes memories?
No. It wasn't till very late on, because I met Phil Collins a couple of times, and first time I met Phil was it was just over 33 years ago, because my father died about 10 days ago, 33 years ago, and I met him on the night after my father died, and because my friend used to drive, was his right hand man, he used to drive him about, and so I was a big Collins fan, but I didn't know too much about Genesis, in all fairness, and my cousin, who I adored, Anthony Mason, who left us, he educated me on Peter Gabriel, and he and I took him to a show one night to see Gabriel, and fell in love with him. His music he was way ahead of anybody. I had most of his music. This was just a super song that, you know, really does tell it all, doesn't it? You know, Don't Give Up. And it reminds me a lot of, obviously, we're talking about the times we're going through now, and there's a lot of people suffering, and it takes me back to when I was in hospital, and it was, you know, it was either fight your way out of this. They said I'd never walk again. One doctor said I'd never walk again, and introduced me to another doctor and said, this is man. I said, we'll never walk again. And luckily, I can say that I've never been so happy to be wrong. So I was faced with something, you know, and it's all about not giving up. You know, even if it's your last breath, you know, you just don't know. You don't know. And I think that song really tells you the story about that.
And I think what we'll do, we'll dedicate that song to all the heroes out there that are keeping so many of us alive during these awful times. The doctors, the nurses, the medics, and anyone that works in arguably the greatest thing that we have in this country, which is the NHS.
Well, I think at the time I found out with my year in hospital when I come out of my coma in around March of 98. I was supposed to be working in France for the World Cup. I'd been over there with my friend, and I was supposed to be working, you know, in a different for him. And I ended up watching it on from my hospital bed, and I used to have the young doctors and nurses in my room, and my mum used to feed them, and they were just fantastic. They were, you know, until you've been there and you experience that, you just don't know how good these people are. They really are. They're young kids. They're coming in. They're so up, and they haven't got two pennies to rub together. They don't get paid that much, and they give, you know, they care so much. And I used to take them over the pub and whatever, and in my wheelchair, which was another thing. And they're just fantastic people. And I said to two or three professors that, you know, I do realise the difference between you people and football managers, because you study and you become what you become because you've worked for years in this, where football managers don't even, they just give them the job and that's it, you know. Yeah. How do they get the job half the time? I don't know.
And the difference is with this disease that we've got now, we don't know where it is. It's an invisible disease. We don't know who's carrying it. Back in your day, when you had that hit and run, which was an attempted murder, it was an attempt on your life. Yeah. You had a 50, when you were just referencing that coma, it was a 59 day coma, Al. I mean, you were so lucky, really, to pull through that. And the amount of operations that you've had since, to think that you're still alive and working and walking around with us and being part of our lives is quite incredible in its own right, isn't it?
Well, yeah, it's it was something that, you know, nobody knows when it's nobody knows when it's their time, do they? It's you can listen to whoever, but nobody knows. It's what I mean, I remember the day so clearly, of having a fantastic day out. I had a wonderful day out at lunch, and I was working for the Sporting Life at the time, and I had a great editor called Tom Clark, and he invited me along. And I knew friends, Ray Winston was there, I remember, a couple of boxing friends of mine were there. I had a wonderful time. I had a wonderful night on the way home with another friend, and we were talking about Christmas and what Christmas was going to bring for me and my friend Henry. And he said how happy he was, and he was talking about his partner. He would never give his partner up for all the tea in China. He's never been so happy. And I wasn't very happy in my relationship. I'd only been married about 6 months. I knew it was going nowhere. And lo and behold, you know, we hugged, wished each other Merry Christmas, and 15th of December, and I woke up in March. So who knows?
It was incredible. I mean, what memories have you actually got from that time where the car struck you? Because, you know, the police looked at it, by all accounts. I mean, it was an attempt on your life, no matter how people want to look at it. It wasn't just Alan Hudson, as the papers put it. Alan Hudson has been there, he's had a night out, he's walked in the road, the car's hit him. It was very, very sinister, wasn't it? What was your actual memories about that impact? And didn't that car smash you into a tree, which really internally messed you up as well?
Yeah, it threw me, actually. I was to find out that I see the photograph of the car, because the solicitors had to show me that.
Yeah.
But I said, what happened was the police said that I stepped in front of the car, which number one was very sinister because I know I didn't.
Yeah.
But the last thing I the thing I remember, the thing that stands out in my mind is when I used to come home. I was in Holborn, and I used to take a train. And when I used to get back to Whitechapel, to Bow, I used to make up my mind to swap out the line and go closer to home. But this particular night, it was such a beautiful night. It was December night, and it was like summer.
Yeah.
And it was incredible. And I thought, no, have a long walk. And, you know, after the chat, I just had a conversation I just had with my mate, Henry. I just walked in and taking it all in. And I always used to cross the road at the same place because I used to cut through past the police station where I got hit and walk through past the supermarket. And I remember I'd always do it when I crossed over. I'd phone my wife and said, look, I'm going through. I think it was it was in Roman Road, a supermarket there. I used to walk through the back and go out the front when I lived basically there in Roman Road, and to ask my missus if she wanted anything bringing in, and she said no, and I never got to the other side of the road. It was and there was nothing on the road. There was absolutely nothing on the road. It's like a four lanes in Whitechapel Road. I think it's the biggest road in England apart from a motorway.
Yeah.
I can remember it vividly. I was so clear headed about everything because I remember it being such a beautiful night, and I just thinking. I remember I got a phone call in the daytime that somebody wanted to see me. He read my sporting life piece and he wanted to see me about a bit of work the following morning. I never ever got to find out who that fella was because of the accident. So there's many things. So my head was clear. I'd had a good day out socializing, a very, very good day out because I was in good company. But there was something in the back of my mind that told me that I wasn't right about. And when I left the second place I went to after the luncheon, I said to Henry, we walked across the road at Holborn, and I see the lights. There's a bar called James, it used to be Jamie's Bar, which always reminded me of Jamie Redknapp, funny enough, because he lived up the road, and young Jamie, and I used to drink in there quite a lot with my friend. And I said, come on, we're going to Jamie's Bar. It was just lit up like, you know, so tempting. It was like luring you in there, you know. Yeah. It was the only one really lit up, and I said, "Come on, Emery, we'll finish the night off properly." And I always thought, because when I was telling Emery about my situation at home, there was three or four fellas in businessmen in suits, and they recognised me. They kept looking over, and they were a couple nodded kind of thing, you know. And they were very, very close to our conversation. If they were listening to our conversation and how worried I wouldn't say worried. I don't know what the word is. I was concerned about how Christmas was going to be, and you know what mood she was going to be in when I got in, and how it was going to end up, how Christmas was going to be, and if these people standing next to me, if they had put on the radio at 5 or 6 o'clock the following morning and heard the news, they might have even thought it would have been a suicide.
Yeah.
I was that way. That was how my conversation went.
Yeah.
But nothing ever come of it. My friend, a very good friend, I speak to him 2-3 times a week, who lives in East London, and he said there was only one witness. And he said the two cars were revving up at the traffic lights behind. I didn't hear it, but there was no danger at all. But he said he heard this noise, and next thing you know, this car was gone. Mm. And then the next thing you know, he was going to be my witness, but the police went round there and threatened him. You know, started asking him very personal question about his own life, and he cried off. So I was left with no witness.
Incredible.
It's all very Godfather like. And it's so easily done. It's so easily done. It's, you know, it, and I had a brief, the my wife and their family, they got me the solicitors, and the solicitor kept coming into my, and I ended up throwing the solicitor out and got a new solicitor, someone I knew, because he kept trying to talk me into saying that I walked in front of the car. It was just crazy, really.
Incredible. Your second track tonight, Al, The Beatles, Get Back. I've got to say, personally, one of my favourite Beatles songs as well. And I think 1968 they recorded that, didn't they?
Well, as I say, I read that thing yesterday. I didn't realise it was the last time that they last recorded together. It was the one on the rooftop, which caused a lot of it didn't co well, it caused a problem to some people, because not everybody likes the Beatles, and people don't really, there's a lot of people like enjoying themselves, but I certainly would like to have been on the roof with them. But it was a time when they, it's like, how can you? It's like going back to Maradona. He would probably say that wasn't the best goal he's ever scored, because he scored so many like it. And that's how great players and out this world players feel. And like Sinatra, name the best Sinatra song ever. Well, you can't, because there were so many. And the Beatles were like that. They didn't have the best song, really. They just knocked some fantastic songs out one after the other, didn't they? We've done on your show before the Bee Gees, and you just can't pick a best song. The Beach Boys, you just can't pick them. But this was a great track, and it was quite appropriate for that.
That rooftop situation, it was Let It Be as well, wasn't it? I think it when they promoting Let It Be, because they almost, as you alluded to, that was the last one, and it was quite a famous situation. Because can you remember any other bands that have recorded on the top of a roof? It was all they. I mean, they were quite wacky, and they were quite maverick in their own way. And all four of them, of course, had different sides to their personalities, didn't they?
Well, absolutely. I mean, it's like a football team. You've got to have different people and different ways of thinking. There's no doubt that Lennon was a boss. He was the wackiest of the lot, and he was the most forward of the lot. They had three geniuses and a goalkeeper, really, didn't they? A goalkeeper that weren't very good. And as we said on the show before, when Lennon was asked, "Is Ringo the, you're the best group in the world? Is Ringo the best drummer?" And he went, "He's not even the best drummer in the Beatles, let alone the world." So that just about summed Lennon up. But Lennon was behind all the success, I'm sure. And it's like playing in midfield, me playing in midfield with someone who's also a little bit different, with like George Harrison. When they split up, and he made his album, All Things Must Pass. He showed his genius as well. He was nobody's fool, And of course, McCartney is the only one that really has never gone forward for me. McCartney, I used to really like him when he was younger, but he hasn't really done too much since, I don't think.
Now, with Lennon and McCartney at Greenough and Hudson, Who is George Harrison? What football player from that Stoke team?
Well, George Harrison would have been probably he was
Sammy?
he was I don't know, he was probably John Mahoney. John
Yeah.
Mahoney was my sidekick in midfield, and he was the one, you know, although George had class, and Mahoney was one of those would never get noticed, and he would I always used to say him, I say to Terry Conroy, I said to him one night, I said, and I'd done this chat one night, and I said that when we used to train, and John Mahoney used to train, you would never think that this fella could play football. He was useless in training. He couldn't. He wouldn't run. He wouldn't. Didn't do a cross country. He couldn't sprint. He couldn't do nothing. He never touched the ball in a five-a-side and nothing. But Christ Almighty, on a Saturday afternoon, he was quiet in the dressing room. You never knew he was there. And there he was, you know, when it come to the bell going and you're going walking through that door, I just looked for him, and I remember Tony Wadham pulling him aside one day, having him in the corner one day at Bramall Lane, and we needed to win badly, and Tony Waddington didn't usually used to do this, but he had him pinned in the corner. And there was no doubt telling him that you've got to stop Tony Curry today. That's your job. And he did a magnificent job with him. And he did the same when we were 2-0 down against the Leeds when they were going to break the record. And I kind of looked at him as much as to say, Josh, you've got to get hold of Giles and I'll get hold of Bremner. We've got to turn this around. We were 2-0 down, and they still talk about it up there as the greatest game ever at the Victoria Ground. So I would say Mahoney was, you know, you don't want, you want him in your team. I wouldn't like to play against him every week. I want him next to me.
And while we're still in the Stoke dressing room, and it was half time, and did you get it back to 2-2, didn't you? Because Leeds United took an early lead and then had a goal disallowed, I believe. And then you guys come back into the game, 2-2, half time, the studs are going in the dressing room, the bell's going, and you've come out, and then I think it was Dennis Smith from a corner that got the winner. Not only one of the greatest games for Stoke City, one of the greatest games in British football.
Well, I think for the neutral,
Yeah.
I think the whole country must have been listening onto the radio. On the radio, they must have heard that we were 2-0 down. Oh, Leeds are going to break the record, and the Leeds players were just swanning around. When, as you say, they scored a third goal. Joe Jordan scored a header from close range header, and he was given offside, which he was. But had it been today, God forbid, if VAR were there and they hadn't given it. And Christ Almighty, would have been 3-0 down. That would have been impossible. It was a mountain we couldn't have climbed, no matter how well we played. But we still felt we were in it. And my friend Mickey Padgett got the first goal from a free kick, and then I equalised. Got scored my first goal for the club just before half time, about half an hour in, and I just knew we were going to win from there. And the crowd were just unbelievable, you know. They were definitely a 12th man, but that was a great game. I mean, Leeds weren't the force. In all fairness, I think they. I don't really know. Someone come in, one kid. I can remember a kid running in the dressing room after the game. He was doing the Leeds dressing room. He was only an apprentice, and he said Jack Charlton's just smashed the window in, or someone's just smashed the window in, and put his fist through the window. They were enraged, and up the just along the corridor, which was fantastic, you know. So that's what it meant to them. They see it as they threw it away, but we were superb, and from number 1 to 11, our team. But we were a very, very good team at that time. You know, it weren't like one of those you see in a cup of. A shock or nothing like that, but, you know, we fancied ourselves, because on the Wednesday afternoon, our governor took us up to see him play Bristol City, and Bristol City knocked him out of the cup in a replay on the Wednesday afternoon. So, you know, that was a bit of forward thinking by Waddington again, but although we weren't very happy going there because that was Wednesday was our day out around all the Stoke local pubs. But we deserved that, and we would have went on to really great things if the roof hadn't fallen, really.
So it was a case literally of You Win Again, which again is another song on your playlist tonight from the Bee Gees, one of your favourite groups. But let's just indulge a little bit in that Stoke City team for probably two or three seasons, because that's what you were there for, really. You joined Stoke. I think, did they draw at Ipswich when you joined, and that they were in the bottom three, and you said to your uncle, blimey, what have I done here? I've joined these. And then you pretty much transformed Stoke. And for two or three seasons, Stoke City were one of the great teams in British football, and you were a nap whisker away from winning the Football League. In fact, in 75, when you played, you made your debut against West Germany, the very next game, you beat Derby County, who went on to win the league on goal average that season. You beat them 2-1 in the mud, didn't you?
Yeah, we did. Yeah, I mean, we were flying at that. Yeah. We were playing really well. And we couldn't see any other result but winning the league. Yeah. You know, our own form was incredible. But it wasn't just that we were a super football team at home. And we were very hard to get the ball off, which was the main thing. But I didn't realise at the time, because everything went a bit pear-shaped. We were still on top at Easter. That was when the Shankly thing with Liverpool. And I didn't realise, and of which I've read up on, that we got three broken legs, I think, in the last 10 games or something, which I didn't realise. I read something the other day about Patrick broke his leg in one game, and I didn't do it, by the way. So I'm one of their players. But he broke his leg, and he went. He came back on with a broken leg. That was the kind of spirit that we had, and I must say that's the kind of thing Pedge would do. But we had three. I think it was three, maybe four. I don't know. But yeah, we had some bad breaks at the end. But that's life, isn't it? You know, Who sees what's coming. But I'm sure that wouldn't have bothered Tony that much at the time. I'm sure he would have seen the bigger picture and thought that, you know, we proved that we can get there and we can go on, because two or three of our players were getting on age wise, but we had good replacements coming in. You know, people like Alan Dodd were coming in, so there was no problem for the future as regards losing them players. They were terrific players, all of them had been terrific Stoke players. But I'm afraid, like with Manchester United, who we played that year and they got relegated that year, all their players got too old together. Yeah. So it comes to an end. But we weren't. I was still only 25, 26.
Yeah, you're a young kid.
Sammy was about the same. So Jimmy Greenough was only about 27, 28. So we would have been the elder statesman in that team with the youngsters coming through. So, but we'd have had the experience by then. And someone once said that we didn't know how to hold on to it when we got there. But that wasn't the case. That certainly wasn't the case.
Mileage still left in that Stoke City team, wasn't there?
Well, there was there we still had a good side. You know, we had Jeff Hurst up front. He was coming to the end, but he could have you could replace him then. You know, it's a shame that Osgood didn't sign when he reneged on the deal. But yeah, we could have. I think it was better things to come. There's no doubt, and I'd say that because the manager was so cute that he wouldn't have gone that far. He wouldn't have built that club that far and let it all go. He was really on the ball, and you know, he was the most devastating man in the world when the roof fell in, and we had no money, and they had to sell me and Jimmy and Pedrick, so they had to get there. And then later on, obviously, sell Shilton. But and then at the end of the day, you know, that's why there's no Victoria ground now.
It's quite incredible, isn't it, really, when you look at uninsured stands and then... Because it was 1976 and it was the January of 1976, so it was the greatest summer, arguably, that any of us had seen, but we had a terrible storm that blew in the January and blew the roof off, and it's quite incredible, really, how things pan out.
Well, it's actually that. It's a little bit like this. It is actually. Well, it's like me talking to Don Shanks last week, and I'm saying we'll be in Portugal next week to see my son play, son's team play. They're playing in Portugal. And now here we are locked up and, you know, a country in absolute turmoil. But, yeah, it happens, part of life, isn't it? You know, but... I take it a little bit more personal than everyone else because it always seems to happen to me. You know, it happened at Chelsea with Osgood, and then it happened at, you know, they couldn't pay for the stand at Chelsea when they got rid of us. And then obviously it happened again, and things happened again after that. And then the Mile End Road thing. And so you do ask yourself sometimes if someone's following you about, you know.
Quite incredible. And who else is quite incredible is the Bouvin end at Stoke City, and there are some tremendous Stoke City groups, and I mean quite a few because of the work that we do. And I mean Stoke City was almost my football club that I was going to support, because when I was a babby, I actually thought that I was talking to Gordon Banks, and it was my dad's mate Alan Keating, who used to play centre forward, and he used to say, "Son, Gordon Banks is on the phone for you." So I was almost going to be a Stoke City fan. And there's that picture, the iconic picture of you and Pedrick at Gordon's funeral, wasn't it, I believe, when you were standing literally nose to nose, and lots of people were saying what was said. So let's go back to that picture briefly. What was said when you're nose to nose with Pedrick?
Well, it started before that, Paul. It started I went up with my friend Martin Knight, and we booked into the hotel. I dress, because of my experience with Betty Shine, she told me one day about going to a funeral. She says, "Are you going to celebrate someone's life? And you shouldn't wear black, shouldn't wear black ties." So that was out of the question. So we travelled up from London that morning, and to show respect. I love Gordon Banks. I loved him as a goalkeeper. I loved him as a fella. So there's no way I was going to miss that. And we went into the pub opposite the church, and all the Stoke fans were there. And they were all singing, and all the photographs bit and autographs. And it was great. It was a fabulous day, you know, because of the occasion. And then I walked into the church, and you had the 1972 team standing on the wings there, which I weren't part of, and they kind of looked me up and down, and Pedrick was the one that had to say, you know, "What you dressed like that for? Show a bit more respect." And I said, "Well, I'm showing my respect because I've just come 150 miles to show my respect for a man I love. So that really hasn't got much to do with you." But he was a man that said something, you know, early on when I first got there, and he was still keeping his kind of, it's not really, it wasn't really a feud, because I never fell out of him. I just got on with my life. I just think things like that were so petty, you know. And if it had been the other way round and he'd have travelled 150 miles down to London to see me in hospital, I'd have thanked him for coming all that way. And I see that as a wrongdoing. You don't judge people by what they wear and how they show their respect. If they can actually put their self out and go 150 miles, I think that's great. I just, and a lot of the times I do that at Stoke is because I've done it before. I went to a do of their 25 years of winning the League Cup when they beat us, and I went because I truly believe that I was representing Tony Waddington. Yeah. Otherwise, I wouldn't have bothered. I wouldn't have gone as myself. Why? Why would I want to go? I was on the losing side, yeah. And good luck to them. I didn't feel it at the time, but I was glad they won. You know, when I got to Stoke and got to know them and everything else, and I was just pleased they won it for my manager, and for the people of Stoke-on-Trent. I would never have felt that way if I hadn't joined them and had the experience that I had there, which was just phenomenal, you know.
And that was the difference, wasn't it? There was, you know, the two dressing rooms, the Chelsea dressing room, you were a band of brothers, whereas the Stoke, and you're on about, like, Pedge judging you quite recently at Gordon's funeral, God rest his soul, but they judged you when you was a 22-year-old kid coming up because they didn't like you, did they? It was like, it was an us and them, and the first time that you met your pals there at Stoke was in the Place nightclub, and it's like, well, I thought that we'd meet you here because that's what you're like. So they had an opinion of you and a wrong opinion of you even before you turned up at Stoke-on-Trent.
Well, they might have had the right opinion of me. because at the end of the day, I am what I am, and they are what they are. And the only time they use the word mithered, don't they? Only mithered, it ever bothered me was when Tony gave me a different coloured bib in training and told him to pass the ball to me. And I said, Tony, what you done here? You're making me enemies from day one. And that's how it all began. And they just, not all of them, but, you know, because I was very friendly with a few of them. But two or three of them, they just went their own way because they didn't like it that I was a record signing and everything else. It hadn't been done before. Tony paid money they'd never heard of, and they were probably thought I was earning 10 times as much as them, which couldn't be further from the truth. I don't even know what I was earning. I didn't give a monkey about money, and I just wanted to get my career back on track, and Tony did it. So I'm proud to say that I did it on my own. I didn't need any help from any of them other players. Where at Chelsea, I won the FA Cup and the European Cup and the European Cup Winners' Cup in the first two seasons, and I wouldn't have been able to do it. I thank Peter Osgood for that because his goals did it. He was a difference. So I do know. I'm not stupid enough to think that without me they wouldn't have done it, because I know that Osgood won us some trophies, and I know in the FA Cup in 1970 that Peter Housman saved our life from a couple of occasions and got us through to the final. So it's a team game, and we all, and as you say, but that was a difference between Stoke and Chelsea. We had not everybody in Chelsea dressing room. We wasn't all buddies, you know, but the majority of the lads in there, you know, it was really great time, fun to go in. Whereas at Stoke, it was different, you know, it was more, I enjoy myself as much at Stoke as I did at Chelsea, but in a different way because they're a different type of person. And I love Stoke-on-Trent. I love the people there because I love them for their honesty. And that is something that I believe I've got.
100%, Al. We've been doing this for such a long time, and we're keeping our social distance again tonight. You're in World's End and I'm in Bartley Green in Birmingham. Even the nights are better by air supply. So what's the story behind the tracks there? Because you are a big fan of air supply, aren't you?
Well, I found air supply they would have been going long before, obviously, but they were just a band. There were two chaps from Australia, and I just heard their music and fell in love with them. And my friend who kind of lived with me, Tony, the little TD, Tony Davis, he lived with me in Seattle for most of the time. He come over on holiday once for a month, and he was over there for about 7 months. And and this song represented our nights in Seattle, really. Even the nights were better. And when I come out of my coma, they were telling me about who come in to see me and who didn't, and how horrified they were, the state of me and everything else. And Tony told me, someone told me Tony was holding my hand and as I was on life support, and he was singing Even the Nights Are Better, thinking I was going to wake up. I said, it's the last song you want to hear when you're out stone cold. So that song is, although it's a wonderful song, it really is a wonderful song. It always reminds me of coming through the coma, which is a typical Tony, you know.
Just been you, then you came to me, and my loneliness left me. I used to think I was tied to a heartache, that was the heartbreak, but now that I've found you, even the nights are better.
And I guess there, you know, even the nights are better. You know, you got them nights there in your, well, it was almost like a club that you had in your house in Bellevue. And then you had your pub in your hospital, the White Hart, just over the road. And towards the end of it, they actually had to say to you, look, you're using this hospital like an hotel. So whatever you've been, you know, wherever you've been, whatever you've done, you've always had great nights, haven't you? It's part of Alan.
I was looking earlier on at how many people had died already in this with this virus. You know, it's you think of all the families, and you know, it's heartbreaking. You know, people are heartbroken at this moment. It's really dangerous, serious stuff, you know. And I've always been of the opinion that and I've always said to young players, please don't, you know, you must go out and enjoy yourself, come out with us and enjoy yourself, but never ever, going back to Maradona, you know, never ever come in the next morning and not put it all in. You know, you must train as hard as you put. You got to train even harder if you're out. And that was, I think, the key to actually me staying alive. That could have been another song we could have used, Staying Alive. You know, because, you know, I think I've always said that the last training session I put in on 15th of December 1997 was the most important one of my life. I'd done a couple of hours on the bike, and I'd done about 2,000 sit-ups, and then I went in the steam room after I did some more exercise. I just come out there, and you know, and I thought, here we go again. You know, we're going to lunch, My philosophy is go and enjoy yourself, because you know your life might end today, tomorrow. Why, you know, and these people that, you know, some people don't want to go out and socialize, some people don't want to drink, that's fair enough, but enjoy yourself, whatever it is, you've got to enjoy yourself. I mean, there's no better feeling than to laugh, and there's no worse feeling than to cry and be sad, and there's a lot of people sad over the world at this moment in time. They've lost their loved ones, and it's a terrible time. But when it all does pan out, hopefully sooner rather than later, that, you know, they might realize that, you know, to go out and enjoy yourself a little bit more. I mean, I'm very lucky in many ways. I haven't got much money, because otherwise I'd probably kill myself, you know. Who knows where I'd end up, you know, especially with things always going wrong. But I think I've always, my friends would tell you, you know, and they laugh at me when I, you know, even if I have a day in, they laugh at me. They bring me up, you know, say, what's going on? Are you not well? And I say, no, I've got a day off sometimes.
How are you coping with all the pubs closed? And you are a very social person. You like to go out, whether it's the bookies or, you know, you like to be in with people and talking to people and socialising.
Well, I'd tell you what, Paul, I've been very, very lucky. I've got to, it's incredible, really. I've only got a very small fridge and freezer, but I got, my friend Don Shanks called me the other day and he said, meet me downstairs. I met him downstairs and I let him in my flat and he brought me a package with, he had a bottle of vodka and he had a few bits and pieces to put in my fridge. And then all of a sudden, my mate Tony Millard yesterday rang me up. He said, meet me downstairs. He's got a package. without the vodka, but of food, and today I received a package from America from young Anthony, saying, "Dad, have you got that package?" So now I've got too much food. I can't get it in my fridge. So all these people are going in there and nicking all the stuff off the shelves in supermarkets. They could come round to me and take some of mine.
It is just mad. And, you know, you've got to have a little bit of humour in there, because these are dark times. And I think that the one thing with us British, you know, in times of adversity, we, you know, we look at ourselves and laugh. And you've got to feel for Philip Schofield, haven't you?
Oh, poor old Philip. He's just come out and then now he can't go out. It's unbelievable. Yeah, I've always said, in, you know, when I was going back to when I was in hospital, it was only keeping up my sense of humour that got me through it. It's no doubt about it. If I'd have been serious about it all, you know, I'd have felt, I know, I've seen people do it. I'd have still been in my wheelchair. I'd have been in, but, you know, as I mentioned to you, you know, the day that we went over to the pub over the road, and I was in my wheelchair and I was with my cousin Anthony, and I just waited for him to go to the bathroom, and I thought, now's the time. I didn't think there was anybody in the pub. It was a Sunday morning and nobody was about. And I just put my hands onto the bar and I was not really that strong upper body, and I just forced myself up onto the bar out of my wheelchair and ordered a drink, and the governor nearly fell over. He said, "Well, how you got out of that?" And then next thing you know, there's a party of six people and behind me, which I didn't know were there. They start applauding. So it was like watching a film, you know. And then my cousin comes out of toilet wondering what's going on, what they applaud, and they see me standing there, and he's gone, fucking hell. He said, "We've been trying all this time to get you out of that thing and you do it in the pub." So there's a lot to be said for pubs.
Yeah. But there is, and that's it, because, you know, I mean, we all like a drink, we all like a tot. And you're here for a short time. You might as well enjoy yourself. And for all the things that you've had, the adversity in your life and the operations, I mean, how many operations you've had today, Al?
Well, I've kind of, I don't think they really know. I don't know if it's 50 or 60 or whatever, because every day in the I remember one day in the in the ITU, they couldn't even take me to the operating theatre. They had to bring the operating theatre to me because they said I would have died.
Yeah,
I was too weak to take, and so they brought it into my room and they operated there. So that's how good these people are, you know. And I remember one doctor actually saying that. In the trauma meeting, let's not bother with this patient anymore, because he's got no chance. And obviously the great David Goodyear come around and see me and put him in his place. So he's probably the main reason I'm here.
And another band that you love, and another band that are a bit wacky, the Beach Boys. I mean, almost a barber choir, weren't they? And probably that's how they started. But what great harmonies and what great vocals and what a great band.
Well, I read this thing yesterday about them being in love with the Beatles, and one of the Wilsons wanted to be a Beatle. That's what made his mind up to be a rock star, listening to the Beatles. But I had a strange feeling that it was the other way around. Because I was more into the Beach Boys. I think they were the I think they led the way for harmony, surely. In my eyes, you know, they're the most fantastic, incredible group, and I think that's why the Beatles and the Bee Gees got it from. I think that, you know, but then, you know, they all, it's like a footballer and probably a film star, you know, you've all got, you know, you all love your peers. Or And that's why I was going mad about Maradona, because you think, oh, I was good, but Christ almighty, you know, how good's this fella, you know, how good was this fella, you know, and it I don't like it when people badmouth them, you know.
No, absolutely.
How much pleasure they give the world, you know. Yeah,
again, about pleasure, about entertainment, about enjoying yourself. Okay, he overindulged at times, but you know what, don't we all at times? But the song that you've picked from the Beach Boys, and then I Kissed Her.
Well, I walked up to her and I asked her if she wanted to dance. She looked awful nice and so take a chance. When we danced, I held her tight. Then I walked her home that night, and all the stars were shining bright. And then I kissed her. Each time I saw her, I couldn't wait to see her again. I wanted to let her know.
Now, that was recorded by another artist as well, wasn't it?
That was the Ronettes. I can remember the Ronettes done that. Yeah. That was when, because I was well into Tamla Motown at that time. You know, I loved Tamla Motown, and it was just good. And I think everybody was. How could you not like that kind of music? Yeah. And yeah, they did. And then He Kissed Me. And they turn it around, you know, and I think it's just a great rendition. It's just a fantastic, and it just suits them so well, you know. And it's strange how they picked that song, because they picked a wonderful song and they just turned it around and made it even better. It's just a lovely song.
And I guess in these times, with our social distancing, we can't get kissing the girls. We can't get kissing anybody at the moment.
Well, no, we're not even allowed to shake hands. they shook hands before the Liverpool. They didn't shake hands before the Liverpool and Atletico game, did they? But they were kissing when they scored.
Exactly.
So, you know, what's all that about?
And then after, they all embrace each other and they're sweating and they swap shirts and you just think, what is that all about? But it does bring us nicely to our last record, which is The Beatles. And I Want to Hold Your Hand, which I did look at Neil Diamond the other day, because there's Liam Gallagher's done it as well, and there's a number of them on social media where they've reworded some of their popular songs with, like, hands touching hands. No, don't touch hands, keep your social distance. But back in 1965 with the Beatles, I Want to Hold Your Hand, that was a massive hit, and again, another wonderful Beatles track.
Yeah, it's funny. I sent it through to you yesterday, I read the piece, and it was strangely enough, it was Paul McCartney. Well, he was going out with Jane Asher at the time, and he went into the other room, and he shouted down to her brother Peter, and he said, "Pete, I want you to come and hear something." And they played it to Peter Asher, and he said, "You got to make that play." He said, "No," he said, "play it again for me. So I don't believe what I just heard." And he played it again. He says, "That's just a ready-made number one in any country in the world." And they sold, obviously, straight away 250,000 copies, and they went on to sell 5 million. And that's when they cracked the American market. So it's all down to that one song. I don't say it was the best song they've ever made, but it was the song at the time, wasn't it? You know, and obviously the girls loved them, so it was typical, and that's all they want to do is hold their hand. It was, but they can't do it today, I'm afraid.
But this is the thing, isn't it? If you're going to write a song, have a make-up or a break-up song, because it will sell millions, won't it? Especially if it's got a good chorus, good melody and good harmonies as well, which the Beatles always made sure that they had that.
Well, they were the kings. Yeah. They were the kings at that. They were so, you know, and even when they changed their style and they went into, you know, with the Maharishi and all that, you know, they were still unbelievable. They just produced so much great music, didn't they? You know, no matter what, from Strawberry Fields, A Day in the Life, which we've had, fantastic. They were just genius, wasn't they?
And again.
Yeah, again, I mean, again, going back, you know, it all ended up in tragic with Lennon, you know.
Yeah, you know. But again, another group that liked to enjoy themselves and indulged. And I think if there's a message and the thread through this podcast has been, one about hospitals, about never giving up, about the fact that we're living in such awful times at the moment, but still look at the day in front of you with a smile, with a sense of humour, and then perhaps we'll get through it. But if you cow down to it and you've been negative, you know, you let things consume you. You've got to embrace it and just, you know, it might be your last day on the planet. Who knows? Just enjoy it and just enjoy life, because life is short and precious.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think it takes things like this to hit home to people. It takes a tragedy for something to hit home. And for those that don't want to enjoy themselves, you know, to carry on. But I'm sure, you know, I got so many phone calls the first day of when all this happened and when they were closing the pubs and what we're going to do, what we're going to do. I said, well, you're going to have to get on with it. I'm used to it. Mm. I spent a year of it in hospital, although after 6 months I found the White Hart over the road. But that's the way it is, and there's nothing you can do, you know. I bet the funniest thing, I'd like to go around to all the prisons and interview them and think see what they're thinking at this moment. Because they are now, you know how it feels, you know, being locked up.
Yeah.
So it's a terrible thing, because it's not just a locking up, it's a fault. I mean, I went out earlier on, and it's people, you know, there's fear on people's faces, you know, and it's a terrible, terrible time.
And it is the thing that when you're locked up, when you're, you know, in that confined space and you feel almost as though you are a prisoner in your own four walls, you know, you've got to have that social interaction and phoning up people, phoning up loved ones, phoning up your parents, phoning up your mates, you know, going on to FaceTime and interacting and just, are you okay? You know, probably knocking on your neighbour's door, especially if they're old, and keeping that social distance. But, you know, are you okay? How's things? And do you need anything from the shops? And we can, you know, I think we've learnt an awful lot about ourselves over these last few days. And I think that, you know, if nothing else, I think we've learned a big social lesson, and we've learned how precious life is, how important people are, and there is nothing more important than love.
Well, there's another song we missed
exactly,
out, isn't it?
Yeah. We have got part nine, though, Woody, next month.
But, yeah, I think it hits home. It takes something tragic to hit home to people, you know. And we were talking about it in our local, where we meet, what we're going to do, you know. And I think there's a couple of people might have even threw themselves off the bridge or got the razor blade out, you know, because there's nothing else to do. Where do you go and meet people? Even when we could go out, you know, where do you go and enjoy yourself? You're going to a library, you're not allowed to talk. There's only, you go to the cinema, you know, the cinema goes, a lot of people go to the opera, but, you know, people like to, where do you go and talk about our favourite sport, you know? It's a pub. I mean, without the pubs, there'd be no football. In fact, because there's no football, even more pubs are closing down now because football has been keeping them going for so long. That's how important it is.
And at the moment, there's only three pubs in Britain that's open. That's the Queen Vic, the Wolfpack.
Well,
and the Rovers Return. And I think they're closing them as well.
Well, yeah, I don't think I fancy going up there anyway.
So we're going to go out with a big message, and we're going to have another Beatles track. All you need is love, Al. So till next time. Those are the days, my friend.
Those are the days. Another Beatles song. And I thought they'd never end, but they come back to haunt us again, Paul.
And we will come back for part nine next month. And let's hope that in a month's time, it does look a little bit more rosier, and we're going to be going out. And when we do get out of our roses, it's going to be one hell of a party, or do
you? Oh, yeah. I'm more positive than negative about this.
Absolutely.
This will end a lot sooner than what people say.
Yeah, it certainly will.
We got to think that way, if not anyway, because if you live any other way, then, you know, you're living hell.
Definitely, mate. And I'm going to make a train journey down to London to buy you the drink, and we'll have a tot in the Golden Lion when it's open again.
Why not, mate? Why not?
Cheers, Al. Till next time. Catch you later, pal. Lovely.
Cheers, pal.
Thanks, Al.
Bye, mate.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Oh, yeah, I'll tell you something. I think you'll understand. Say that something. I wanna hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand. Oh, please say to me.